Hey, so in this video, I'm going to show you how to do simple financial statement analysis in Python using the Y Finance library and Matplotlib for visualization. So we're going to use Python and Y Finance to pull in historical prices. That'll be very simple, just warming up. Then I'm going to look at some financial statements, and this comes out of the box with Yahoo Finance or with this Y Finance library. So if you're ever interested in looking at fundamental data, maybe you want to look at various ratios or different accounting metrics. I'll show you how to get those. And then we'll actually build what's called a comps table, which is kind of a traditional finance. Maybe if you're an investment banker, you've heard of this term. But basically where you're looking at various multiples across different companies, so like Apple, Microsoft, Amazon, and so on, and looking at their common fundamental metrics like their revenue and their free cash flow. And I'll show you basically how to build this out very easily in Python, so you can impress all of your investment banking friends with the fact that you actually know how to code. So let's get right into it. So first of all, our imports will just be pandas for a little bit of data. All of our data is going to get returned to us in pandas data frames. And then we'll have Matplotlib for the plotting, and Y Finance is the main library that we're going to be using. And this is just an open source library that supports an interface to the Yahoo Finance API. So if you've ever gone on Yahoo Finance to look up a stock price, this is what we're working with here. In terms of the version, make sure you're using at least 0.2.54. I have 0.58, but just make sure that you're using a version after 0.54, because there was a bug fix that went into it. So the first thing I want to show you is how to get price data for multiple assets, and it's really, really simple. We're just going to do yf.download, and we can pass this in a string of comma-separated stock tickers, a start date, and an end date. And if I rerun this here, just so you can see it run live, you see that we get a data frame back where our first level of the columns are open, high, low, close, and volume, and then the second level is each individual stock. So, and then obviously our index is the date. So this is daily data. And this is really useful because with just one line of code, we can get all this data for all these different instruments. And there's really no limit to this. I could put 10 things here, 20 things here, and it'll run pretty quickly. Now, something I might want to do pretty often is just look at the close prices for all three of these stocks. And I can do that by using this XS function, which stands for cross section. So it's like I'm taking a cross section of this multi-index data frame, and I pass in the flag axis equals one to take that cross section across the columns. So when I do this, right, we just get our Apple, Google, and Nvidia data back, and that's obviously the closed prices. So this is a very kind of way to do it, right? This is what I'll typically use if I want multiple assets. But another way to do it is to actually use this thing called the ticker object. So here I'm going to define a yf.ticker object for Apple. I'll just pass in a single stock ticker, and I'll get back this yfinance.ticker object, right? And it's encoded as Apple. And now I can actually get the price history for Apple just by itself, all the same, using the history function. And I'll pass a start date and an end date, just like before. And we get open, high, low, close, volume. And then it also throws on dividends and stock splits here, if that's of interest to you when you're querying this data. Now I can also pass history and intervals. So I'd say, instead of daily, maybe I want every 15 minutes. I want every 5 minutes. I think it even goes down to 1 minute. But then there's limitations on how far back you can go. So you can get maybe 5 minute data for the last 7 days, but not for the last, almost 5 years here. But I just want to show you two ways to do the same thing, basically. But there's a lot more that we can do with this Apple ticker object, and this is where things start to get a little bit interesting. So first, I'll show you our earnings calendar. So obviously, we know that earnings are a pretty important component of how the stock market works. So right now, actually, as of the time that I'm recording this, most companies are reporting their earnings. And I'll show you actually just what we can get off of Y Finance and off this ticker object. So the first thing I'll show you here is this earnings dates property. And it shows us also in the form of a data frame what all the earnings dates are that are upcoming. So and even kind of historically as well, right? So right now as I'm recording this, it's around May 2025. So here is where I am. And we can see the last couple earnings dates as well as the upcoming ones. And we have NAN values for the future values, obviously. But we have our EPS estimate, our reported EPS, and then if there was a surprise or not. So that could be something that you might want to look at, even if you're a fundamental trader, right? Even if you're a discretionary trader, you probably want this data. You want to at least be able to get this data quickly. So this is very useful. even if it's not incorporated in some algorithm or some alpha signal. Now we can also see our earnings history. Again, we just get our EPS actual, the estimate, the difference, and how much of a surprise it was. And this is quarter over quarter for the last four quarters. And we also get some notion of our earnings estimates, right? And specifically like what, you know, analysts thought and things like that. So this is pretty cool that we get this out of the box with Yahoo Finance. I don't think a lot of people know that this data is so easily available to them for the stock market. And also, by the way, you'll notice at no point have I added an API key or registered an account with Yahoo Finance. Like, I've just imported this library here and I can just get all this data pretty freely in my Jupyter notebook. Now I want to show you the financial statements. So if you're really, really a fundamentals guy, like you like to read 10Ks and 10Qs and things like that, we can actually load in the three different financial statements, like the balance sheet, statement of cash flows, and the income statement. I left that one off, but we have an income statement as well. Let me add it back. All right, I don't have to add it back right here because it's being a little bit slow to load. But basically, my point is, here we have our balance sheet, and you can see again as a data frame, all of our different line items are the index, and then we have the last few quarters, right? And it's really like simple to access, right? We just go our ticker object and call the balance sheet off of it. And here we call the statement of cash flows off of it. And I'll show you a couple. Oh, here's the income statement. Sorry. I guess it got pushed down. But yeah, so we have our three different financial statements, and we can actually just start pulling these different values off for different quarters and plotting them out and seeing what they look like. So here, for example, I've just pulled off the revenue versus the net income for Apple. And you can see here that the indices are at slightly different scales. So I've just kind of made a multi-index here, or I should say axis here, right? We have two different y-axes here, but you can just see exactly how revenue versus net income has grown over the last few quarters. And yeah, it's something that's pretty useful to see visually. Here's another one. We can plot out Apple's free cash flow. By default, this would be a line chart. It might also be useful to look at it as a bar chart. So because we're operating in the world of pandas and matplotlib here, we can just use the same API that we're very familiar with. And honestly, most of this is kind of formatting stuff. really, all this plot is the first line pulls off that free cash flow metric, and then the second one just plots it out as a bar chart and gives it a title. All right, so it's really not that crazy here. But now, the last thing I'll show you is how to make this comp table that I was alluding to beforehand. I'll scroll down to the result just to get you a little bit excited, if you get excited by this sort of thing, because it is a very pretty looking, colorful chart. And this is what we're going to make. So basically, you can see here on the left, all of our index, or our index is the ticker for all the stocks that we're considering. And then we pull off their sectors, their revenue, net income, free cash flow, blah, 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 net margin, PE ratio, and so on. And then we add a little bit of highlighting as well, so you can kind of quickly spot some of the outlier values here, and how different companies perform relative to, or not just perform, but you know, how they're doing on these different things relative to their peers. So let me walk you through how I built this here. So it's gonna be a little bit more complicated than before. We're gonna need to loop over basically a list of symbols, and this can grow and shrink as we like it to. So here I've got a very short list of symbols, you know, just Apple, Microsoft, Google, so on. And then I've also included some non-tech stocks, right? Like J&J, UNH, JP Morgan, you know, and so on, ExxonMobil, Visa. And these are just going to be what we're considering, you know, for the table. Like I said, the way the code is written, you can add or remove as many of these as you want and just grow your comp table instantly. Now here we're going to track our rows in a new empty array. And finally, we're just going to loop over the different symbols in this tickers list. And first we're going to create a ticker object like you saw before. And then I'm going to wrap this in a try accept block here, just in case anything goes wrong, right? So this is going to be like error handling. So if we don't find a value, or maybe we passed a bad ticker, something that got delisted, then it's robust to handling that. And then inside the try block, we're just going to pull off everything that we need, right? So we'll pull off the income statement, the statement of cash flows. We'll extract the values like the revenue, the net income, free cash flow, and so on. And then we're going to just basically calculate, you know, the different metrics that we need. So like the net margin, the revenue growth, the PE ratio, And in all of these cases, it's robust to error handling. So if any of the values are missing, we'll just get a none back, right? It'll basically be like an NaN value. And then finally, once we have all of our values prepared in variables here, we're going to create a dictionary where the keys are kind of the label or the column that they're going to go into, and then the values are obviously just the values. And we're going to take that dictionary and we're going to append it to the rows list. So we're just using our Python data structures here to ultimately build up a list of dictionaries with all of the different values that we want. And at the end, we're going to take that rows list of dictionaries and pass it into the data frame constructor and set the index to be the ticker. And then this is just a display value, and then we're going to actually sort these values by their free cash flow yield. And that gives us just the raw data frame. And then the last thing I've done here is add in some styling here. So this is kind of a cool trick you can do. Basically, I've taken in this data frame and then done .style.format and passed in different parameters. And you're free to look up how exactly these different parameters work. But you can kind of see some of these are just formatting, how many decimal places to use. Here we're using some gradients, some bars, things like that, right? We have a little caption on here. I wish I could make this a little bit bigger. I haven't figured out how to do that yet. But yeah, that's pretty much it. And we get our final style data frame here. Now I can go and I can export this to HTML or to a CSV file or an XLS file, right? Like a spreadsheet. And again, I can just use this to flex on all my investment banking friends, because now I can do this entire workflow in 10 seconds just by adding any ticker that I want here, and they're going to be stuck at the office at 1 a.m. doing it themselves. So yeah, that's pretty much it for this video, guys. I will post the link to the code in the description below if you want to grab it for yourself. You'll be free to do so. And yeah, that's pretty much it. So this is not the end of what you can do with Yahoo Finance. I think there's a lot more that it has available to it. But this is a very good start, especially if you're interested in looking at financial data. So I'll see you guys in the next video.